What's going on? Why is Dave Chappelle going to Africa? Why does Mariah Carey make a $100 million deal and take clothes off on TRL? A weak person cannot get to sit here and talk to you. Ain't no weak people talking to you. So what is happening in Hollywood? Nobody knows. The worst thing to call somebody is crazy, is dismissive. I don't understand this person, so they're crazy. That's bullshit. These people are not crazy. They're strong people. Maybe the environment is a little sick.
Katy Perry started out really as a gospel singer, writing songs for the Christian community. She went to Hollywood, and she was getting nowhere. She was failing as an artist. If you look at her now, she basically faced the fact that, listen, you're either going to have to get into the Luciferian satanic part of this, and your career is going nowhere. So look at her now. Look at the satanic themes in her videos now. And now she's famous. Now she's making millions. Yes. Millions of dollars. Then you go to Lady Gaga. You want to see some satanic activity in a star that was made a huge star despite bizarre shows on stage, drinking blood out of hearts and things like that. That should disgust most people. There is Satanism all through Lady Gaga's videos, all through it. Stuff that should shock and disgust most people. There is no doubt in my mind, Tim, that to get in sectors of Hollywood. Because there is a lot of talented people out there. There are a lot of extremely talented people that never make it in Hollywood. And they look at America's Got Talent. These people just come out of the woodwork and they're phenomenal. But they never make it in Hollywood because they have to go through this, and you nailed it. They have to go through this screening process. Listen, if you want us to make you famous, you're going to have to engage in some of these sex acts.
Maybe a motherfucker brings you into a room and says, this $50 million, this pile of money, it's all for you. And when you try to grab it, he just throws his dick right on top of it.
You're going to have to get into Satanism and Luciferianism. And they explain it as a higher level of thought, higher level of energy. You know, they don't bring out a person in a red suit with horns and a tail. They present it really deceptively and so that the person thinks that they'll get energy. But they also make it clear you will not succeed in this industry unless you cross that line and you accept Satanism and you accept this sort of activity and you accept the Illuminati side of Satanism, which is the one eye. You'll see all through Hollywood the covering of one eye, all over the place. That is an Illuminati symbol. It is a satanic symbol. That's right, the triangle with the hands. I'd encourage your viewers and listeners to go out and just do some Google image searches on Lady Gaga and some of these other people and just look, especially at the one eye signal that they're giving. It is rampant through Hollywood.
Thank you. Dave Chappelle went on stage with, you know, and was in the audience. There was a group of young people there who were interested in becoming comedians or becoming actors or what have you. And Dave went there to, you know, to tell them about the business, about the Illuminati. Because David felt that what they had said to him in the executive office, he wanted people to know what was going on, just as Martin Lawrence wanted people to know, just as Britney Spears wanted people to know, just as some of the stars here today want people to know about the Illuminati.
Oh, man. Yeah, oh, you guys are going to learn a lot tonight.
What can they learn?
You know, like, you guys are students now, so you're idealists, but you don't know about what art and corporate interests meet yet. Just prepare to have your heart broken. Like, in a way. You see him laughing, that evil laugh? Because he knows, man, and everybody laughs at me, but just get your Africa tickets ready, baby, because it's coming. It's coming. We have no idea.
And as I said, that's why these people are so misguided in their fears that we want to have anything to do with them. A perfect world to us would not include most of these people that are so frightened of us. And perhaps our philosophy ultimately will lead to their removal, but in a way that they'll never understand. What's going to hit them is going to hit them so hard that they'll never know what hit them.
Hurt the young and that you're a psychopath? Is it like a gang initiation or why does it keep manifesting?
Alex, you're one of the foremost commentators on mind control, and I would tell people that not only does David Talbot do an excellent job in The Devil's Chessboard, documented how CIA with Nazi scientist help got a really good, and Yale University help got a really good job, really good grip on mind control.
That's what they brought in, the Angel of Death to help.
Now it's far advanced. So what we have here is pedophilia and mind control and blackmail and bribery are all part of how the deep state, which begins with the Rothschilds and the Black Pope, the Jesuit Black Pope, and the City of London, the bank, Wall Street, they use mind control and pedophilia and blackmail and bribery to basically manage the Freemasons, the Knights of Malta, and other secret societies that are willing to betray every national, corporate, and cultural loyalty.
What I'm gonna speak on is the thing that's on my mind the most. You know what I'm saying? The thing that we all gotta deal with every day, but don't really know. The industry. The industry. Man, it's not the same. Doesn't have to do with talent, it's about playing the game. The industry. Real niggas is dying to get in. The industry, just to find they don't fit in. The industry ain't what it used to be. The industry's trying to control the way you MC. They want you to dress like this and talk like that. But I'm going dress like this and talk with the bat. The industry. Got your word meaning nothing. The industry. F*** what you heard because he's bluffing. The industry. Money. Bitches hate, but I dare you to try to take thing off my plate. The industry like, wait, but in the streets we like, get 'em. 17 up in that thing, catch 'em sleeping and hit 'em. The industry, if you ain't got a strong mind, the industry will break you down. It's a matter of time. The industry, vultures with nothing to feast on. See me, I'm getting my beast on. The industry, stay in the dirt, play in the dirt, test the wrong one in the industry and you will get hurt. I'm not an industry artist, I'm an artist in the industry. So I do what the f*** I want because nobody can finish me. The industry, wanted, dead or alive, new artists to sell their souls in the way they survive. The industry, don't give a f*** about you. but the industry couldn't make a dime without you. The industry, I'm sick of this industry shit. The industry playing them like a industry bitch. They tried to finish me quick, but I am long, so I stand strong. F*** a beat. Listen to the words in the damn song. I only know how to speak the truth, you know what I'm saying? So I got a little short joint I'm gonna hit you with, you know what I'm saying? And it basically reflects on my relationship with the industry. This is what it is. Often my words fall on deaf ears. Motherfuckers be listening, but don't hear. Talking to a nigga, he be sitting right here. I be like, where you going? Nigga be like, yeah.
Is there anything else you'd like to say to the people who are watching this tonight?
Pray for me. So I pray for you. Don't believe everything you hear. Don't believe everything you read. And only believe half of what you see. God bless you.
Being the artist that I am, at Sony, I've generated several $1 billion for Sony, several billion, and they really thought that my mind is always on music and dancing, and it usually is, but they never thought that this performer myself would outthink them.
Yeah.
We can't let them get away with what they're trying to do, because now I'm a free agent.
Yeah.
I just owe Sony one more album. It's just a box set, really. It's with two new songs, which I've written ages ago. Because every album that I record, I write, like, literally, I'm telling you the truth, I write at least 120 songs every album I do. So I can do the box set and just give them any two songs. So I'm leaving Sony a free agent. Owning half of Sony. So I own half of Sony's publishing, and I'm leaving them, and they're very angry at me because of it, but I just did good business, you know.
Say it, Michael. Tell the story.
But, so the way they get revenge is to try and destroy my album.
Well, the timing of this Michael Jackson shit is what makes me doubt it. Every time this war is going out of control, or the economy gets bad, or something is wrong with the world at large, it's always these moments in history that Michael Jackson will coincidentally jerk off a kid. This is getting a little ridiculous. Like, are you planning this shit? Do you have meetings?
Michael, thank you for coming. As you know, Michael, the war has not been going as well as we expected. There's been a lot of hiccups, and the public is asking us a lot of questions, of course, and, well, Michael, there's no nice way to say this, and all I know how to do is be direct, so let me just be direct. We're gonna need you to jerk off another child, Mike. I'm sorry. I am sorry. But it would really help out.
This is very important because throughout the years, Black artists have been taken advantage of completely. And it's time now that we have to put a stop to this incredible, incredible injustice. And like Mrs. Sharpton was saying, people from James Brown to Sammy Davis Jr., some of the real pioneers that inspired me to be the entertainer that I am, these artists are always on tour because if they stop touring, they would totally go broken. And it's been, the record companies really, really do conspire against their artists. They steal, they cheat, they do whatever they can, especially the Black artists.
Can you see a time in your life ever when you won't be doing stand-up?
This past year, I did the least stand-up I've done since I started. I was freaked out, man, with the fame thing and being called crazy and drug addict and all these things. Scared me. You know, being treated that way. Like, I'm not a person anymore. Say this shit about me in front of my children. Really, like, who the f*** do these people think they are? And they don't know what happened. You know, I have not spoken about what would make a person walk off the set of a successful show and go to Africa. I wasn't walking away from money. I was walking away from the perfect storm of bullshit.
They told you I was in an insane asylum. They told you maybe he smokes crack. They told you everything but the truth. Maybe corporate America fucks with human beings like their products and investments. Maybe a motherfucker brings into a room and says, this $50 million, this pile of money, it's all for you. And when you try to grab it, he just throws his dick right on top of it.
Thank you.
But David called me again, and he said, cuz, they called me again. I said, who called you again? He said, the executives. And he said, they want to talk to me one more time. And they're thinking about the possibility of me doing the Chappelle show and doing it the way that I want to do it. I want to be, he said, because the only reason why I told them when I talked to them the last time that the only way I would do the Chappelle show again would be if I did it my way. And it would be set up on my terms. And so I received a phone call, and they want to talk to me about it. Well, my antennas went up. I said, David, now you be careful now. I said, because they could be saying that. He said, no, I really think they're serious this time, cuz. He said, because I made it definite with them that the only way that I, he said, I told it on Oprah Winfrey's show too, that the only way that I would do the Chappelle show again, it would have to be on my terms, my way, and the money that I make, even if it wasn't $50 million, it would have to go to the people. But it had to be on my terms. So I said, okay, David. I said, well, do you trust him? David said, yeah. I think I can trust him this time. So I said, well, David, whatever the situation is, please give me a call. He said, you know that's right, cuz. And so David left. We hung up. We hung up. I have not heard from David, not even today. I have not heard from David. Now, what I think is this. That Neil Brennan is a question mark, 100%. A question mark. I believe that David went there, and they discussed it once again about the $50 million. And I believe Neil Brennan was somewhere in that office. I believe he was somewhere in that office. And then they told, I'm believing that they told David that they wanted him to see something. Just like they did Bernie Mac. Oh, yes, indeed. They took Bernie. And let me stop on David for a few minutes. But they showed Bernie Mac the cloning lab. And they showed Bernie Mac the cloning lab. And he went down and he saw how people were being cloned. And when Bernie Mac came back and told Steve Harvey and D.L. Hughley and a few others, and that he saw the cloning lab, and that something had to be done to stop that foolishness of what they were doing. Well, Steve Harvey and D.L. Hughley went back and told the top brass of the Illuminati, the dark circle, inner dark circle, and what they did, they killed him. Okay, so now let's go back to David Chappelle. I'm truly believing that they told David they had something they wanted him to see. And they took David to the underground cloning lab. And when they took David down there, I'm believing that before they took David down there, they promised David that they would go along with David's deal, to get him to sign the contract. And I'm believing that David, thinking that he would get back on the Chappelle show, working with Comedy Central, that everything was going to be all right. And I'm believing that David signed that contract thinking that. And when he signed that contract, they wanted David to go and look at something else. It could have been maybe a new, telling him that maybe it was a new studio or something of some kind or what have you. But they got David after signing the contract, you can say in blood, and David thinking that he's just signing the contract because things were going to work his way. And then once he signed the contract, they took him someplace else, and the place that they took him to was to the underground lab. And when they got him down there, they cloned David. And when they clone a person, and I want you to do your research, it's not like cloning is not like when a woman gets pregnant and they either eject her or, you know, for her to have a clone or the baby girl, however that goes. It's not like that. Cloning today only takes a couple, maybe to several hours to be cloned. Well, this is what I strongly, strongly believe they did to David. They took him to this underground lab. And what they did, it is smiling in his face and you know, just going along with David so that David would not yield up or fight or this sort of thing. And they cloned him. And once they cloned David Chappelle, then they killed David Chappelle. Okay, and once they killed David Chappelle, that was it. Now they could do anything. It only takes a few hours to do this. And once they did this, then they had full control of this new Dave Chappelle. Now, some of you are thinking that when David first met with the executive, he signed his name in blood. I'm telling you all, no, he did not. When David first met, when they offered him the $50 million, no, he did not. No, he did not sign his name in blood. And I'm wondering if he signed his name in blood, you know, even with the second time he met these executives. Because now, if David refused on the first time, and he told me that he was finished with him, and then he told me that, you know, the only way he would go back, and I always believe, because David had no reason to lie to me, his wife or his mother or any of his family. So, but now, when he went back the second time, and I believe David refused, but, you know, they had to clone him. And then once they clone him, this is what I'm thinking too, maybe this is a second phrase that maybe I'm thinking of, that when they cloned him, then they got the clone to sign David's name for not only $50 million, but the $60 million as well. Okay. And so this new person that you see out, let me say this. I had not heard from David when he was supposed to have met with the executives the second time, and Dave promised me and assured me he would call me to let me know the outcome. I have not heard from David since. When I turned my television on and I saw this man there on some kind of show, and he had one pants leg rolled all the way down and the other one rolled all the way up, and they said this was Dave Chappelle. I said, Dave, who? And I went to the television and I looked and I said, hell no, that ain't no Dave Chappelle or no Dave Chappelle. No, hell no. And so I got on the cell phone and I called my cousin David. And I called, the phone rang and it rang and it rang. I think it was maybe on the fourth or fifth ring that someone picked up the telephone and said, hello. I said, let me speak to David. And the person on the other end said, who are you? I said, I'm David Chappelle's cousin. And the phone clicked. It clicked. It went dead. So I called the number right back up again. And the phone rang and it rang and it rang. I never got in contact with David. Now, I called David's brother, William, you know. Didn't get an answer from him either. I don't know what had happened, but I didn't get an answer from him. But when I saw this man on television with one pants leg all the way down and the other pants leg rolled up, I knew damn well that was not my cousin, not my Uncle William's son. Hell no. And when this new Dave had his pants leg rolled up, that was a symbol of the Masons. Now, David Chappelle was a practicing Muslim. My cousin, Felicia, she's a practicing Muslim all the way. You see, David has children that has Muslim names. Now, why would all of a sudden this David turn from Muslim to Mason? It didn't add up. okay? And then when they began to show this new day pictures of him, and I knew Darvin well. That wasn't David Chappelle.
When Martin Lawrence was in that chair, we talked about Blue Streak.
I love that dude.
He played a role in your life, I believe. How do you feel about him as a person, as an artist?
Martin Lawrence is the guy that showed everybody you can make it from D.C. to Hollywood. And I had a personal stake in his success. Every time he did something, it made me feel inspired and really good. And he was always real nice to me. He'd sit me down, what's going on with you, baby boy? What? We'd talk about comedy, whatever. And, you know, when we did Blue Streak, we were promoting it, you know, and Martin had a stroke. He almost died. And then after that, I saw him, and I was like, oh my God, Martin, are you okay? And he said, I got the best sleep I ever got in my life. That's how tough he is. So let me ask you this. What is happening in Hollywood that a guy that tough will be on the street waving a gun, screaming, they are trying to kill me?
Yeah.
What's going on? Why is Dave Chappelle going to Africa? Why does Mariah Carey make a $100 million deal and take clothes off on TRL? A weak person cannot get to sit here and talk to you. Ain't no weak people talking to you. So what is happening in Hollywood? Nobody knows. The worst thing to call somebody is crazy, is dismissive. I don't understand this person, so they're crazy. That's bullshit. These people are not crazy. They're strong people. Maybe the environment is a little sick.
First, David went to the inside the actor's studio. He was asked to come and be on the show with the host there. And, they, you know, David was fine. He went on the show, and the questions was asked to him, why did he go to Africa, and what went down? And I remember that David told exactly, you know, the same thing that I'm telling you now. That how, this whole thing was kind of shaking, you know, and he didn't want no parts of him. Then he also went and he told about Martin Lawrence. Now, Martin Lawrence, you know, they did the same thing to him too. But Martin Lawrence, and no one today, we have not seen Martin Lawrence. No one knows where Martin Lawrence is, because you know why? Martin Lawrence is dead. I mean, body, soul, spirit, dead. If you ever see a Martin Lawrence come back on the scene, it's because that Martin Lawrence, before they killed him, they made a clone of Martin Lawrence, and they have that clone in waiting. Waiting for what? I don't know. But no one has seen Martin Lawrence. No one knows anything about Martin Lawrence anymore. But if you ever, and I say to you all who all are listening, if you see Martin Lawrence, then you know that he's a clone. And because they were supposed to, Martin Lawrence and Will Smith were supposed to be, they supposed to have done a film that was supposed to have came out last summer. Well, the film never did come out. Why? Because there was no Martin Lawrence.
I think that America needs an honest discourse with itself. It's like the greatest country in the world by default. You know what I mean? But we could actually be the greatest country that ever existed if we were just honest about who we are and what we are and where we want to go, and if we learn how to have that discourse. Things like racism are institutionalized. It's systemic. You might not know any bigots. You feel like, well, I don't hate black people, so I'm not a racist. But you benefit from racism just by the merit of the color of your skin. There's opportunities that you have. You're privileged in ways that you may not even realize because you haven't been deprived of certain ways. We need to talk about these things in order for them to change.